This is the way most of us are used to seeing deer. These deer in Pittsburgh, New Hampshire, appear to have made it through the winter unscathed. But to some, there's trouble here.
I don't have anything real.
Will Statz, North Country wildlife biologist for the New Hampshire Fish and Game Department, doesn't like what he sees.
This shows how desperate these deer are and how used they're being fed. This is extreme. I mean, this is a situation where these deer have just been so used to getting fed all winter, and they're so desperate to get some feed now that they're coming out to total strangers right on the roadside. And they're in very poor shape. You can see that. You can see their hip bones sticking out, their back bones, rib cages.
These deer have been coming to this private feed station all winter, leaving behind their most important survival tool, good winter cover. Deer in the North Country have adapted to the extreme winters. Research has shown deer typically lose about 20% of their body fat and conserve their energy by feeding on natural vegetation near their deer yards.
Six striped maple.
But once lured out of their traditional wintering areas, the scales are tipped against them. Traveling miles away from their deer yards, they expend critical stored fat energy that may have carried them through the winter. And they risk increased predation, road traffic, and are more susceptible to disease and stress.
I've been into historical deer wintering areas where there aren't many deer because they're all being fed down at the highway someplace. So deer are actually teaching their young to go to these feed stations rather than using the traditional yarding areas. Deer feeding has actually influenced deer movements and patterns of behavior. And of course, that's a setup for disaster. This is a fawn. This is one of the most common animals we find dead in the deer yards. They're the smallest animals, obviously. And to determine the health and condition, we look at the femur bone. This is the bone here. We look at the condition of the marrow. And we open it up. And you can see in this femur bone, the marrow looks like red jelly. We call it red gel. And it indicates there's very, very little fat left in the marrow. And this deer is in the advanced stages of malnutrition. This is an adult deer, and I'm going to be able to age it by looking at the teeth. And by the wear on the teeth, it indicates that this deer is 5.5 years old, which is not uncommon to find. Either the fawns die during the winter or the older aged animals. And this animal is certainly older.
To better understand the impacts of supplemental feeding on wildlife, researchers at the University of New Hampshire have been conducting studies at the Brentwood Wildlife Research Facility for decades. Here, captive deer are used to closely study deer physiology, something that would be impossible in the wild. And now, the offspring of those deer are going through feeding trials with UNH graduate student Matt Ross. Matt is devising an easy and inexpensive way for biologists to see how much supplemental feeding is present in a given area by tracing lignin. Lignin is a type of fiber found in the feces of deer that have fed on natural vegetation.
What I'm doing is using the deer here at the Brentwood Wildlife Research Facility as my reference set. We're feeding them different proportions of natural vegetation or browse in five different components and grain that would simulate something that somebody would put out in their backyard in the northern parts of the state.
This stuff is going to go back to the lab, and we're going to measure exactly how much is left over from what we offered them, and we're going to be able to determine exactly how much each deer consumed per day for each of the five species collected. How cold it's out until you start picking up feces.
Once collected, the feces is dried and ground up to a fine powder, then sent to an off-campus lab for analysis.
I hope my study will end up giving the New Hampshire Fish and Game Department a way to predict, inexpensively, way to predict where grain is being put out, supplemental feed is available in the state, so that they can better educate the public around those areas.
This looks great, you guys. Well, this cover looks good here that we left. I think we made the right decision leaving that.
Essential to deer survival in the North Country are deer yards like this one. Will Statz works with large landowners up north to preserve dense canopy.
We're constantly looking up to see the amount of crown closure, how little light is coming down through, because obviously the denser that crown closure, the less snow that's going to get to the forest floor, and the easier it is for deer to travel through these kinds of places.
The deer also develop trail systems in them so they can more easily escape predators. Landowners here understand the importance of winter cover and work hard to make sure the land will continue to be used by the herd.
We are working on trying to come up with a better definition of exactly what is deer yard and what isn't. But if we think we're close, we really just give Will a call. You know, we try and balance all of the different strategies there, you know, with from Will from a wildlife perspective and us from a timber management and financial perspective.
Many people might argue that too much research has already been done on deer. But with each study comes even more questions. And as the situation in the North Country continues to become more complex, researchers will strive to find the answers to help keep wildlife truly wild.